Our next speaker will be Brad Richards. He's the Director of Alumni Relations for the University of Pennsylvania School of Engineering. Brad manages a portfolio of engagement initiatives for undergraduate, graduate, and PhD students. He works with the development staff to achieve the philanthropic goals of the school through meaningful one-on-one relationships with Penn alumni and friends of the school. Most recently, Brad worked for 5 years as Associate Director of the Wharton School. Prior to that, he spent 15 years at his family's chemical company, Richards Apex, where he founded a subsidiary in Sydney, Australia in 2002. In addition to his undergraduate degree in English from Penn, Brad has an MBA from the Fox School of Business at Temple in finance and marketing. His master's degree at Penn focuses on the multidisciplinary study of art history and the role of art in society. In his spare time, Brad's a passionate collector of contemporary art and avid traveler. Fun fact, he just celebrated his 25th reunion at Penn last week.
Okay.
Serves as president of the undergraduate class. His capstone's entitled Culture for Sale, Thomas Aiken's The Gross Clinic. His first reader was Chris Pastor, generally. He also had Gwendolyn Shaw from History of Art and Nancy Watterson. Brad.
I just realized that I may be the least interesting person in the room, so thank you for sticking around to hear my presentation. On the Monday after Thanksgiving in 2006, Ann Darnancourt, director of the Philadelphia Museum of Art, held an emergency meeting of civic leaders, philanthropists, and politicians to announce that one of Philadelphia's greatest cultural icons was up for sale. Thomas Eakins' portrait of Samuel D. Gross, the Gross Clinic, was being sold by Thomas Jefferson University for $68 million to the Crystal Bridges Museum of Art that was being built by Walmart heiress Alice Walton in Bentonville, Arkansas. The city of Philadelphia had 45 days to match the purchase price or risk losing part of the cultural heritage forever. With the clock ticking, the stakes couldn't be higher. The future of one of the greatest works of American art. In a rallying cry to the city elders assembled in the Great Stair Hall, the Art Museum, Darnancourt proclaimed, "To keep the Gross Clinic in Philadelphia is neither provincial nor self-interested. A great American city with a huge reputation in the arts and the sciences seeks to keep an icon of both fields in the city which it symbolizes." So this enormous public outpouring of civic pride led to grassroots fundraising efforts and protests by citizens of Philadelphia to save the painting. Ultimately, in the weeks leading up to Christmas, a deal was struck between the Philadelphia Museum of Art and the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts that allowed the Gross Clinic to stay in Philadelphia forever. As a native Philadelphian, I distinctly remember the near universal solidarity that coalesced around the painting at this time. But just how did a 19th century painting of an obsolete surgical procedure hung inaccessibly for over a century in a medical college staircase come to occupy pride of place in our civic collective consciousness? As I would like to investigate the concept of art as cultural currency and a locus of civic identity through the lens of the Gross Clinic, I begin by analyzing the painting from an art historical perspective to advance a formal analysis of the dramatic power of the painting. I then situate the Gross Clinic at the intersection of the scientific breakthroughs of the Enlightenment and the pathos of human experience of American Romanticism. These intellectual cross currents provide the necessarily dialectical framework to consider fully the cerebral advancement of science and the visceral blood and guts physicality of disease, issues of psychology and physiology, and the visual pleasure of looking, even at a gruesome work of art. Against these backdrops, I explore the Philadelphian-ness of the Gross Clinic, cultural anthropology perspective, in order to demonstrate that this identification with Philadelphia is shaped both by the response to and the solution for the threat of the artwork leaving the city. I also speculate on what was at stake if the artwork had been allowed to leave, and a consideration which calls into question the broader implications of art as prime cultural currency for cultural heritage preservation. So, narrative drama. So, what's immediately striking about the Gross Clinic is the narrative drama of the painting. The dramatic force comes not only from its sort of unusual and complex subject matter, but also from its sheer physicality. The painting measures 8 feet tall by 6.5 feet wide, and it depicts Dr. Samuel D. Gross, famous Philadelphia physician, performing an operation in the surgical theater of Jefferson University. Rendered nearly life-size, the figure of Dr. Gross dominates the scene. His serious countenance and halo of white hair are lit intensely from the skylight above, while in his right hand he holds a bloody scalpel, set off vividly against the charcoal black of his coat. A group of assisting surgeons attend the patient, whose body is obscured except for the pale skin of the buttocks and thigh. Meanwhile, a woman thought to be the patient's mother recoils in horror at the graphic scene. Eakins includes himself in the crowd of medical students sketching the scene from a seat in the surgical amphitheater, while a scribe dutifully records the procedure. Simultaneously, you, the viewer, standing in front of the Gross Clinic, you become an eyewitness to this exact moment when the doctor, having cut into the leg of the patient, turns and addresses the crowd. For all of its cinematic immediacy, however, the subject of the Gross Clinic is both overt and confounding. As the painting's first reviewer, William Clark, notes, the Gross Clinic is, quote, something of an enigma that requires considerable effort by the viewer to be understood. So Eakins chooses to present this narrative data in medias res, and therefore more comprehensive formal analysis is required to sort of address the significance of the work. So the composition of the painting is essentially is essential to the power of the Gross Clinic. The position of the major figures form an imaginary triangle in the picture plane, with Dr. Gross's head at the peak of the pyramid. One side of the triangle slopes down towards the patient's mother, while the other side connects the heads of the assistants to the right, with the bottom being the tray of surgical instruments that form the base. This compositional element serves literally and figuratively to reinforce Dr. Gross's preeminence at the apex of the triangle. Here, Eakins is employing a technique from the Renaissance, exemplified by Raphael in his Sistine Madonna, to draw focus to the heroic nature of Dr. Gross and confer a nobility of spirit to the figure through the stability, harmony, and pleasing symmetry of the composition. But when you look closely at the imaginary triangle overlaid on the Gross Clinic, however, you notice that something's unbalanced. In her insightful scholarship, Elizabeth John notes, Gross does not occupy the precise center of the painting. He, his patient, and by implication, the operation, are bound up together to form a large triangle with the absolute center of the picture falling just off Gross's shoulder above his patient. So to expand on Jones's observation, I suggest that Eakins appropriates this pyramidal structure to provide his subjects the necessary dignity and formality, but by offsetting the balance slightly, he creates a more modern interpretation that emphasizes realism, originality, and dramatic storytelling. More specifically, I contend that Eakins subverts the natural inclination of the eye to rest, as in the Renaissance symmetry of the visual triangle. Instead, Eakins is purposely trying to have the viewer's gaze move, so it unsettles by the asymmetry between the competing focal elements. This off-center structure results in transferring the dynamism of painting to the emotional reaction of the viewer. Eakins continues to create visual puzzles for the reader to decode. The body of the patient is severely foreshortened, almost to the point of abstraction. The head and face are hidden by anesthesia cloths, while the feet and shabby socks are stacked closest to the viewer. Exposing the left thigh bone to surgical incision, Eakins approximates only portions of the body, leaving the viewer to assemble the jigsaw puzzle of shapes and pieces one by one. Similarly, the mother, on the opposite side of the triangle, is also an enigmatic figure. Scholars have noted that for a work of such uncompromising realism, her representation on the canvas is, quote, curiously out of scale, just slightly too small for her location in the amphitheater, and not quite fitting into the painting as a whole. In addition, the surgical instruments at the bottom dissolve into abstraction. I contend that Eakins is simulating the optical effects of the blurred focus of the edges of our field of vision on the canvas to train our eyes with hyperfocus to the bloody scalpel, the central dynamic element that ties together the scientific and human themes of the painting. I'd also suggest that the Renaissance triangle is not the only visual framework with which to decode the work. Eakins seems to be aligning the action, emotion, and core visual data along two diagonal lines. Specifically, one diagonal from the recording scribe at the top, downward through the figure of Dr. Gross, through the incision, to the assistant surgeons on the lower right. This diagonal highlights the medical and scientific elements of the painting, linking the procedure being documented and performed by the surgical team of doctors. The second diagonal line from the patient's mother at the lower left goes through the scalpel, the standing figure in the hallway, who is Dr. Gross's son, to the seated image of Eakins himself as he inserts himself as a spectator into the scene. This diagonal represents the emotional, familial, and artistic elements of the painting. So these two dramatic diagonals connect the competing elements of reason and emotion that give this work its internal energy. These diagonals of human pathos lead us to a philosophical reading of the painting, which is sort of the second lens. So in the 18th century, it's known as the Age of Enlightenment, and it was characterized by scientific knowledge and empirical evidence that supplanted the reliance on faith and the teachings of the church to define humankind's place in the cosmos. A quest for a rational basis of understanding for the world led to rapid social change and political change as innovation and technology, fueled by the Industrial Revolution, first in Europe and then in America. From 1840 to 1870, however, American Romanticism formed in reaction to the vast changes of the fabric society caused by the Industrial Revolution. Proponents of American Romanticism yearned for a return to an Edenic pre-industrial past. The return to nature was exemplified by westward expansion of America in the 1800s and was seen as a counterbalance to the urbanization of America in the previous century, thus juxtaposing Enlightenment-era philosophy and American Romanticism creates a dialectic between the rise of science on one hand and the heroic human narrative on the other. So we've already seen this evidence of this tension at work in the compositional structure and narrative drama of the Gross Clinic. So you can sort of, if you think about the Enlightenment being the downward sloping side and American Romanticism, the upward. Obviously, this is not encoded by Eakins in the work. It's just a framework to sort of understand how you can read this painting in several ways. So sort of viewing it through this dialectical framework of the cerebral and the visceral, the pictorial elements that Eakin chose to foreground take on a philosophical significance in addition to the purely aesthetic qualities. So here, the head of Dr. Gross is presented not only as a great man of science, but also a heroic figure of American individualism. And the light that illuminates his forehead, therefore, is not merely the noonday sun coming through the amphitheater skylight overhead, but it is the physical illumination of enlightenment inspiration. The figure of the woman can also be reread in the context of the Hegelian dialectic. She is operatic in her conveyance of human emotion, mm-hmm. as her clenched hand through synecdoche provides all the information about her mental state and physical shock. Her narrative role, I would suggest, best function as a symbol for American Romanticism. Her allegorical function goes a long way to address some of the prior art historical critiques of her form and function within the painting. Eakin paints himself into the Gross Clinic and it gains added significance because he's not simply representing himself as an eyewitness to this event, and he did attend anatomy classes at Jefferson, but he is there. He is also the Enlightenment scholar and the romantic creator of art. So due to the constraints of the presentation, I have to condense a lot of information. So I'll just kind of give you the crib notes on Eakins, a Philadelphia painter, lived here all but 2 years. And he was famous for sort of depicting Philadelphia, skull boats on the river, a great deal of portraiture. And he was a student and teacher at Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts until his sort of risque at the time teaching methods of painting directly from a live male and female nude model got him kicked out. Dr. Gross, the most famous surgeon at the time, wrote sort of the hand surgical guide for the Civil War, so both sides were repairing the body as it was being discovered over his lifetime. And I'm also sort of glossing over some of the technical and scientific achievements that have been done to make this sort of work possible, which was things like anesthesia, which would make this shocking because that's a live patient, right? It's not actually a cadaver, which is most of the sort of our historical references. But this is sort of a live person, and this happened right at this time, 1850s. So this would have added to the sort of shock and drama of the piece. And Eakins made this for the Centennial Exhibition of 1876. So it was very much about sort of Philadelphia boosterism, about them putting their best foot forward to the world, and it centered around two things, which was education and medicine, and it's not a surprise that Philadelphia today sort of continues in that vein. But to sort of think about the Philadelphia aspect, I think one of the things that I centered in on in looking at what happened in 2006 was sort of the identity of the buyer itself. The fact that it was Alice Walton of Walmart that sort of added to the sort of deeply held reaction to it. So just from Stephen Kahn, who's a cultural historian that specializes in urban histories, he sort of says, whatever might be said about the historical importance of the Gross Clinic, it's inarguably a Philadelphia painting. It's a Philadelphia story told by a Philadelphia doctor in a Philadelphia medical school by the preeminent Philadelphia painter. So keeping it in the city thus became a crusade about civic identity, about what it means to be a Philadelphia. So the sort of last lens that I looked at this work was through material culture. So the sort of framework of how cultural capital and civic identity arises out of cultural anthropology. So if you consider the Gross Clinic as a piece of material culture, the painting can be viewed as an artifact that embodies, and sort of the standard definition is, a particular achievements, especially intellectual, that characterizes society, such as art, science, technology, and religion. It's got about three or four of those. So it's through this third lens that I want to sort of look at the Gross Clinic. Material culture represents the physical evidence of a society and becomes a touchstone that describes the relationships between an object's making, meaning, and context. There's also something about this identity of the buyer that reinforces the subsequent readings. From a civic perspective, Walmart has a destructive effect on the fabric of local communities around the world by displacing homegrown manufacturers in favor of global distribution. Their corporate business model centers on homogenization of goods and services through low-cost means of production. So Walmart threatens sort of the very survival of mom-and-pop stores that anchor neighborhoods by driving them out through their sheer economic force of size and scale. Similarly, Alice Walton wields her vast wealth to acquire works of American art that are displaced from their contextual environment and shipped to sort of a centralized art warehouse in Bentonville, Arkansas, the home of the world's largest retailer. So I think this felt sort of very antithetical to the neighborhood feel of Philadelphia, the fact that it was sort of trying to describe our sort of place and context. So just a quick note about the solution, about how it actually able to stay, was it was jointly bought by Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Art and Philadelphia Museum of Art. They share displaying the work on a rotating three-year basis. It actually just switched. I took this photo in January. But I think that this is sort of central to this idea of art as being a locus of civic identity. Because if one institution had been seen as winning over another, or if the winning institution limited public access or scholarly research, it would have, sort of had continual claims of foul play, favoritism. But by putting the greater good ahead, everyone could sort of root against, the sort of evil billionaire coming in to take our cultural property. Kind of feels like Rocky, where like Sylvester Stallone could be Eakins or something. I don't know. So this dual sort of shared institutional solution, I think, is really central to pointing out or underscoring the fact that this cultural identity is there because it needed to be that way. So I just sort of end with this sort of broader notion about cultural heritage and cultural heritage preservation. So at its core, the identity of a cultural work is necessarily rooted in a place and community. I think the Gross Clinic exemplifies that. What you can do, I think, is just initially acknowledge that this is true, that cultural artifacts really do share, define who we are, and pass down from generation to generation these sort of deeply held beliefs. And cultural heritage, I think, is interesting because it also simultaneously supports creative individual efforts, but it also unites us in a very deep and sometimes durable ways. The corollary here, I think, is that cultural heritage also provides a buffer against the sort of homogenization of globalization, again sort of represented by this Walmart figure in the story. But the Gross Clinic is about a painter, a subject, and a city that really represents Philadelphia-ness in both cerebral and visceral ways. The crisis of the Gross Clinic was caused by largely ignoring these sort of fundamental aspects of place-based identity. In the most basic sense, the painting belongs here because it helps define who we are. For Philadelphia, my sense of what was at stake if the Gross Clinic were allowed to leave the city is both specific and undefinable. Clearly, the work is, as former director of PMA Ann Donnercourt says, an icon of the city in which it symbolizes. But on the other hand, the work would still possess the same sort of art historical significance if it were hanging in Arkansas instead of Philadelphia. These aesthetic qualities would remain, regardless of location. However, I think this sort of political reaction to the threat of the loss of the painting sort of proves that, by extension, cultural heritage writ large is ultimately a product of time and place, as well as within a broader historical context. So as sort of members of this society, we sort of have this moral obligation to protect social memory and our shared culture. So cultural heritage makes manifest our senses of identity, belonging, and the politics of place, all of which require vigilance to maintain and preserve, especially in this sort of fast-moving, globalized world that we all live in. It's this connection between art and cultural capital and locus of civic identity that helped define who we are and what we believe, and that I found was a lesson that Philadelphia learned just in the nick of time.
Does anybody have any questions for Brad?
Questions? Yes.
When Alice Walton of Walmart buys these paintings, is there, I just don't know, is there a museum in Arkansas, or does she just have them at her personal property or whatever?
So interesting, she was actually going to build her own museum called Crystal Bridges in Bensonville, Arkansas. So she's building it from scratch, and she was on this sort of grand tour buying spree, like the Morgans and the Fricks and of the world. Did, but just a century later. So this was her sort of going on a shopping spree and wanting to tell the story of American art specifically. Mm-hmm. And that's why this piece came under scrutiny. But it's also, I think, she was addressing this notion that that sort of Bentonville was not a destination that it needed, like great cities, to have art as part of its sort of cultural mix, and it didn't have that. And so one way to do it is go out and collect it wholesale. So, yeah.
Was other work by Eakins of the same vein, or was this like the only medical piece that he did?
So, great question. what I have left out of this is another painting that he did called the Agnew Clinic, and it was 14 years later. Mm-hmm. If you'll notice, it's famous, it's a horizontal one in the same sort of amphitheater. Mm-hmm. But I do compare and contrast the differences in technology. They're all wearing white, surgical white. So germ theory has now become a common use. It was not in Eakins' day. They would have put those instruments back on the table and while anesthesia and surgical theater where they could do operations in daylight and other other advances came along. In only 14 years, medical science had evolved to a modern state of what we would imagine it to be today, which germ theory was sort of the main, you know, advancement there. So yeah, he did these two really competing ones, but you know, amongst a whole range of other sort of portraits and interior stuff and sporting stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, really interesting guy.
I have a follow up.
Yeah.
So you say that he's in the painting.
Yeah,
but then
he's here.
Where's the vantage point from? Or he just like put himself in there, but he was behind the scene, like they let him do this live, or how did he capture the image?
Yeah, so Eakins actually went to anatomy classes at Jefferson for 2 years. There's records of him as a student, and it's part of his study. His sort of thing was a very realistic approach to art. He really wanted to sort of understand musculature and, you know, all the sort of thing. So he was not doing it from an imagined, this is not an allegory, this is a very real event. So he is doing it both as a place of very knowledgeable, he was there, he's in this amphitheater, he's seated like other students, so he places himself from a very privileged position in the painting, and I think that kind of gives it some authority, right? He has some credibility that this is, you know, actually how it happened.
But how would he have gotten this angle? It's not like he took a picture of this, but...
Right.
Was it a full amphitheater? Like,
yeah,
oh,
so
okay.
Jefferson created the first medical amphitheater that's basically in the round. And this was how you were able to do it. So yes, you would see it from all sides. And it's also imagining, you know, you as the viewer, right? So I think I kind of mentioned that he allows for that. He allows for the viewer to be sort of sucked into this world by how you approach it. A cool piece if you haven't seen it, go see it. Yeah.
And it's great in the museum as they have the two facing each other.
Yeah,
in the
so
art museum,
at PMA they
fantastic.
Had Agnew Clinic here, so it would have been opposite this wall.
Yeah.
So it was kind of cool to do one of these.
It is.
But I do talk about that.
So where is it now?
So now it's at Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts. Mm-hmm. So it's in the main, it's in the old building, the historical, the museum side. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Before that, it was at Jefferson in a hall or a stairwell or what was
it?
Not
it was
open
a stairwell.
The hall, right?
So literally, it was sort of in this weird stairwell that was sort of inaccessible and it was hung behind this kind of weird.
I had friends who went there, and so I saw it there.
Yeah.
And they were all, they did all. Most of the students were aware of it, and the alumni were actually furious that it was being sold without their.
But the public didn't have access to it, and so this is a very interesting sort of other angle to the story, which is Jefferson says we're a medical hospital, we're a medical college, we're all about education, we're not a museum, we can't do the conservation, they don't, they have no ability to sort of handle what we now know to be $68 million. That's not too bad. So they can. So was it their right? Should they have done it? Did they have an obligation to the city to do something different? What's wrong with monetizing something that's outside of your mission to further, education? So it brings up this idea of who owns it and what's the responsibility of institutions that sort of are caregivers and conservators, So again, I think that's why it had that be the shared institution solution in Philly.
Mm-hmm.